This is the story of the Jewish Catskills, of which it has been said that it is a thing of the past. Or is it?
Smell the air.
I'll smell it. You're satisfied?
It's true that the Jewish Catskills, which was so romanticized in pop culture with television shows like The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel.
Up here in the mountains, I do different kinds of things.
Or the classic rom-com Dirty Dancing, that world has disappeared. And while that's in a way true, the Catskill Mountains in upstate New York is a Jewish hub still, a very different Jewish hub. Today, it's a summering place for Hasidic Jews. I was raised in the Hasidic community and later left the fold. When I look at the story of the Jewish Catskills, I wonder about preservation of Jewish community. Why is one type of Jewish community alive and another a thing of the past? And what does it mean to me, someone who's made such profound changes in my life, about the value of change versus stasis, preservation versus assimilation? In this video, I take a trip to the beautiful Catskill Mountains for a journey into the past, into some existential questions, and of course, to some wonderful fresh air. It's sweltering and empty here in Hasidic Williamsburg, Brooklyn, New York City. This normally bustling neighborhood is asleep during the summer months of July and August. Many people take their whole large family of 6, 8, 10 children and go 100 miles north to the Catskill Mountains, or as it's called by Hasidim, to the country. I'm making the trip too, one of my rare video projects that take me out of my beloved city. The neighborhood we leave behind is very quiet. Many people are away. They've already left weeks ago on a designated day at the end of June. I was here on the day they left. This is what it looked like, a mass exodus from Egypt. On the Hasidic social media, this clip is posted around with well wishes for a Gesinnte Zimmer, a healthy summer. The actual scene of leaving is not this crazy, but people like to joke about it. It captures the spirit. After everyone left, the neighborhood was quiet. Many shops closed for the summer or for weekends. For years, I've watched the neighborhood empty out for summer. Now, for the first time, I'm going to see where everyone goes off to. On my way, I make a stop into my past. I'm driving to the village of Kiryas Joel, 60 miles north. This town is a Hasidic community for the Satmar sect. It is even more insular than the Williamsburg Hasidic community. My parents moved out here from Williamsburg before I was born. This is where I grew up. This is where I was raised, married, had my child, and called my home for the first 25 years of my life. This is truly an astounding place, called a theocracy within a democracy. I grew up with a Hasidic mayor and government, with streets named after Hasidic cities in Eastern Europe like Satmar and Siget and Lizensk. This is my childhood street, Satmar Drive, where I spent many summers boarding, the Yiddish word for being a wild child. Hot, sticky, fun summers outside. Here I was raised with sheltered innocence, yet with a strong palpable awareness of the Holocaust. My grandparents were all survivors. Everyone's grandparents were survivors. They told a lot of terrifying stories of miraculous survival. We breathed in its legacy. It was in the air, dense with a memory of the near annihilation of our people. For our pious elders, the lesson of the Holocaust was that Jews must keep fighting for our survival after such a long history of persecution. For us, their children and grandchildren, this meant not to assimilate. Often we would hear the refrain, "I didn't survive Hitler so my children could become Goyim, Gentiles." This meant that we were not to change our language from Yiddish, not to change from our traditional dress, not to bring in secular culture, television, or entertainment, not to go to college. We learned that the Jews who opened themselves up spiritually to the secular world, even if they tried to continue to stay deeply Jewish, they lost their Jewish identity. I understood in a way that really affected me that the lesson was that you can't have it both ways. You can't have rich Jewish culture and also assimilate. Look, my grandparents would say of Americanized Jews. They wanted to be American.
New York is awesome!
They wanted the best of both worlds. They lost their Jewish world in the process. The second generation lost Jewish culture, and by the third, many intermarried communities fell apart. And look where the world of American Jewry is. I carry these messages with me in a deep crevice of my soul. This is one of the strongest internal conflicts of my life. I don't think about God, faith, and religion in terms of where I come from. I think about what it means to survive. I take these conflicts onward to Route 17.
We're gonna hitchhike up to the Catskills. We know the highway, Route 17.
Further up north, we go deeper into the past, to the story of the Jews who did indeed Americanize. I'm in the Borscht Belt Museum. I'm transported into a world of old luxury, of images of bearskin and romance, of women singing and naughty jokes.
Two old Jewish guys are in Miami Beach and they're sitting there and one says to the other, you know, Sam, I can tell you exactly how old you are, right to the day. He says, that's impossible. I'll prove it to you. Take your t-shirt off. And he's looking at him. He says, I need more information. What do you need? Drop your trunks.
Oh, no.
I can't drop my trunks. We're on the beach. You're an altacaca. Nobody cares about you. You're an old guy. All right. He drops his trunks. He looks at him. He says, you were born on May 17th in 1939. He says, oh, my gosh.
How did you know to do that?
Schmuck, you told me yesterday.
My guide is Alan Frischman. He takes me through a remarkable story of what once was. This is the world I was sheltered from that I never knew. The Borscht Belt began in the 1920s with humble starts. Jews, often immigrants or children of immigrants, Yiddish speakers who aspired to make it in America, lived in overcrowded tenements in Manhattan. And the summers were very unforgiving. But Jews were often not allowed into the Catskill resorts, and so they made their own hotels and bungalow colonies. These were not colonies formed for religious isolation, but colonies formed in aspiration that Jews too could one day be equals in America. It started rather humbly with little schlobby bungalows built around a communal house. But these spaces became incubators of talent, a place of great creative energy, a real moment in history. As many worked hard to fulfill the American dream, the communities exploded with talent, grit, dark humor, the relishing of all great things America had to offer.
Alan King's entire routine consisted of simply reading the obituaries, and the punchline was survived by his wife.
Many young Jews got their start here in life, working in large hotels, cobbling together enough money to go to college for a better life. This was the crux of the great successful Jewish-American assimilation story. The entertainment was the origin for great stars. Stand-up comedy was born here. Yiddish music, theater, dance thrived. Here was the famous Grossinger's Hotel with its own airport and its stars. Here was the famous Kutcher Resort or the Raleigh.
Simon says, this is before eating at the Raleigh. Simon says, this is after.
One reporter wrote a piece calling the Jewish Catskills the Borscht Belt for the traditional Ukrainian or Russian soup that many of these Jews of Eastern European origin enjoyed at the resorts. And the name stuck. It was also called, then as now, the country. But the Borscht Belt began its precipitous decline in the 60s, definitely by the 70s. People stopped coming. They could now fly farther to newer places, and as fewer people came, facilities could not afford to stay open. Some closed, hauntingly staying in their abandoned state for years. There were places that fought to the bitter end not to close during this chapter. The Four Seasons Lodge was a bungalow colony of Holocaust survivors who all spoke Yiddish and knew what it was like to have lived through that dark chapter of history. But their children didn't come, and grandchildren didn't. In the beautiful documentary, The Four Seasons Lodge, we see these elderly folks eke out a few more years before this too finally closed. Did this glorious chapter end because of, like my grandparents warned, assimilation? Because of how untenable assimilation makes to the cohesion of Jewish community? Alan bristles when I say the Catskills died. But he then concedes that a number of A's have led to this decline. Airplanes, automobiles, air condition, and assimilation. Ah yes, we Jews who want better for our kids. It's my own story too. My son was born in the Hasidic community. He spoke Yiddish and once wore side locks. He's now college bound. My parents shunned college. But like the folks of the Borscht Belt, my life has been hard. I didn't fit into that world. I found it often stifling. I didn't connect to the faith of this world, to the harshness of its social pressures, to the sharply gendered roles. I left because, like Alan said, this life was hard for me. I was hoping for better things for myself and for my little family. But as my grandparents warned, wanting better things comes with a steep price. Here in the Catskills, wanting better things was part of what ended such a great era in Jewish American life. Could it be that we parents want so badly to give our children what we didn't have that we forget to give them what we did? Was this end a sad loss of a world that should have continued on, or was it simply the natural end of a very special chapter? I also have memories of times up here. They're very different. My family never summered in the mountains, but I spent many summers farther up north in Summer Girls Summer Camp. And that was wild and fun and crazy and boring and sweltering. We were all girls plotting pranks without ever knowing what the word pranks meant. Every year, I packed up a bunch of masks and crazy costumes as part of my arsenal of stuff for summer camp. By day two, I'd be out of a voice, calling home from the payphone and sending regards like a croaking frog, begging for a nosh box to be shipped to me with licorice. In summer camp, we all believe that licorice made you hyper, a kind of primitive view of drugs. And when I think back, I remember military-style barracks, sagging mattresses, neglected hygiene, and reams of long Twizzlers, which we ate like teens might drink alcohol. This might sound wildly fun, but clearly I'm not the only one who wanted better. Because today's Hasidic summer camps, based on their promotional material, are certainly trying to do better for the children, with plays and petting zoos and sports enactments of the Bible and air condition. Things are changing, always, even if we don't want to admit it. But there are different kinds of change. What Hasidic bungalow colonies look like is still a very distinct story. I come to Monticello for the Hasidic bungalow colonies. There are many hubs of colonies, but the town of Monticello is one of the biggest ones. It's a very closed world here, and I feel myself largely on the outside of the cluster of colonies. Each colony is fenced off and filled with children, women hanging laundry and talking on the phone, sitting around in a coffee clutch and socializing, entertaining visitors. It's a very communal space, even more communal than in Brooklyn, with little privacy and everyone in each other's business. If the Catskills were once famous for entertainment, food, and romance, I'd say they are now famous for young families, chatting, and swimming. Every colony has a pool that's fenced off with a tall wall, and the entrance has two doors, so no woman is exposed while swimmers come and go. The children seem to spend all day in their swimming robes, their special modest swimsuit called the Schwimmkleid, ready for their next splash underneath. I remember spending much of my own childhood summers wearing one myself. In the Hasidic Catskills, the women are here all week with the children, but the husbands only come up during the weekend, staying in the city during the week to work. Traffic on Friday is bumper to bumper as men drive up. The colonies look very different on a weekend day than on a weekday. During the week, the colonies are intense spaces of female friendship and caring for children. This has been going on for many years. My dear friend Pearl remembers being here as a child, overhearing the cries of the women who survived the war. Today it feels so different, with some of the young ladies, fourth generation from the Holocaust, raised in a much less post-traumatic world. But the women-centeredness, that remains. How do they pass the time? Probably chat, gossip, laugh, feel bored, swim. At a family wedding, I asked a relative how she passes the time in the country. She has 8 children. None of them spend their time in front of screens. And yet her answer to me was this: I do nothing and I love it. It's not the kind of thing I'd like. The country is too much extroversion, too much socializing. But I admire the way in which the collective takes care of the kids, in which the women live the refrain, "It takes a village." I stroll around the country roads for many hours, doing nothing too, quite liking it actually. The air is amazing. Hasidic couples go on little intimate walks. Women go brisk walking for exercise. I pass yeshivas where men sit facing the road, peering over books in prayer and study. Male spaces feel even more intimidating to me, and yet the sight reminds me of my grandfather on summer days. It's lovely. I pass school programs for kids, involved in all sorts of joyrides. And of course, there are children everywhere with their iconic icy, here called the Foxy Pop. I don't feel comfortable entering any of these clusters. I am an outsider to them. That's their charm and that's their turnoff. There's a lot of mistrust among Hasidim towards outsiders, and it took me many years to build the kind of trust I have in Williamsburg Empire Park. I am here for just a few days, and I feel entirely an outsider. But there's a great central shopping mall, and that is a lot more open. I head over there. This is where people come walking or driving from their bubbles of their bungalow colonies to buy stuff, to buy kosher food, to use the kosher internet, to buy Judaica, and of course, baked goods. I guess when you get tired of loving to do nothing, you come here. At Onyx, the proprietor, who knows me from Williamsburg, tells me about a major fire that is raging in Williamsburg on Lee Avenue as we speak. There's your harmless dose of gossip. I instantly feel the warm embrace of an insider, and it's lovely. I'm also gifted with pastries like this modest gingerbread lady with a skirt. She tastes of chocolate and rum. She's maybe a little better to look at than to eat. There are filtered computer kiosks and laser games, Judaica and modest clothing. There are pickles and pastrami poppers, but we have no luck finding borscht. In that sense, it seems the borscht belt is truly history. I'm staying in an Airbnb bungalow, very different space, a new incarnation of the little unwinterized hut.
Welcome. We're staying in this lovely bungalow, in a bungalow colony. It's not Hasidic, but all of these little bungalows are being Airbnb'd. I love it. I'm very happy here. We have a full fridge, which I'm not sure what I would do with, since I don't even cook much at home. Bedroom and the bathroom. It's tiny.
In this colony, there are no scattered children's toys or any children at all, and the seesaw is rusted. The pool isn't closed off with a wall partition. Little tiny immodest bathing suits hang from the lines. The woman next door to me graciously shares with me stories about her experience here and about her plentiful fishing catch, which she fished at the nearby lake all by herself.
Mm-hmm. It's a bass. What else did you get?
Yeah, this is bass, sunfish, and that's it.
Very nice.
Small basic.
I have a terrific time, getting kosher dinners in the shopping center and spending hours at the lake, soaking in the beautiful nature and the quiet and the peacefulness of just the few of us here as my soul craves it. I read and play games with my travel companion. I spend some time working, booking walking tours and speaking engagements, some with Jewish groups. The clients are Jewish groups of summer camps and synagogues that are not Orthodox, that are related to the generation of Jews who opened themselves up to assimilation. I love to meet these groups, to listen to the ways in which they seek to grapple with the Jewish question of broadening versus closing down, in the ways in which they seek to find Jewishness outside of closed religiosity. When I speak to them, I learn that they don't share the view that all is lost with change. They find new ways for community, religion, faith, meaning. I like to think that I too find new ways of Jewishness that works for me. Ultimately, I so appreciate that the Hasidic world exists, and I'm so grateful that I had the opportunity to leave it because it wasn't for me. There's a reason I left, a reason so many before me sought something different. They loved it, but it was small and insular for them. I recall how Alan described how hard the work in the colony was. For him, while he lives the beautiful memories of what was, unlike my grandparents, he does not see its end as a regrettable loss. Sometimes it's time to move on. I relate to that. I respect that others see it differently. I'm also very grateful that I get to come back as my new self for brief, satisfying, delicious visits. When I left my community at 25, heartbroken and lonely, afraid of losing custody and terrified of building a new life as an island in the world, I could have never expected this. This generosity and friendliness of the Hasidim who know me is an invigorating trip back home, even as it comes with bittersweet feelings. Maybe the older generation was more either or, you're in or you're out, you can't come back. Maybe some things profoundly changed after all. Change happens everywhere. Stasis is a myth. The community, too, here is changing, even as it holds on to the Catskills and thrives. Before I leave the Hasidic Monticello area, I get one last infusion of delicious food at a kosher bakery. I am told I must try the babka milkshake. This drink, if I can say so, represents everything I've learned here, neatly packaged in a plastic cup with a straw, with a cherry, I mean arugula, on top. It's a fusion of the old and the new, the chocolate babka of tradition and the milkshake of the new. The drink tastes like new world with a kick of old world. It's very sweet. I love it in a small dose. It leaves a lovely taste in my mouth as I head back home, many thoughts swirling in my head.